Previously on Kalahari Meerkats. Cleo, the undisputed leader of the gosa gang, was pregnant, and the group were excited to be getting new pups. But something was wrong, and in a dramatic turn of events, the pups were abandoned by the group at the sour grass burrow just minutes after they were born. This traumatic event caused major instability within the group, and a splinter group formed, led by Cleo's younger sister, Delilah. Another sister, Solo, had been ousted previously by Cleo and hung around on the periphery trying to get back into the gang. When the group split, she seized the moment and joined Delilah's splinter gang. But Delilah had broken an important meerkat law and had fallen pregnant. Cleo did not like this, and trouble was brewing. Eventually, both groups reunited to face a common enemy, the neighboring gang of meerkats known as Yucko's June. So let's rejoin the gosa gang of meerkats. This is Cleopatra, known as Cleo, the alpha female and leader of the group. Gandalf is her partner and the wise protector of the gang. Delilah is Cleo's sister and might well be planning a coup to become the leader herself. Napoleon, the lazy one, doing as little as possible. Solo, allowed back in the fold and not alone anymore. And the four mischievous meerkat kids, Starsky and his naughty brother Hutch, and Priscilla and Matimba, the caring sisters. Welcome to Kalahari Meerkats. Home for the gosa gang is a piece of fiercely defended bush within the Tswalu Game Reserve deep in South Africa's Kalahari. The Southern Kalahari, due to its location and climatic conditions, receives more rain than the Central Kalahari, allowing it to support a large diversity of life. It is for this reason that the Southern Kalahari is frequently referred to as the Green Kalahari. This area is covered with bolt holes and burrows that provide them with shelter and security. The group is part of a photographic study by wildlife filmmaker Rob Brains. Rob's camera captures their every move from the moment the gang surfaces in the mornings until they dive back down to cuddle up for another night in their burrow. By now, Rob has been accepted as a full member of the gang and can therefore follow and record their adventures from a meerkat's perspective. Last night, the gosa gang united to be at full strength when facing their territorial enemies, the Yucko's June group.
A brave move by Cleo to fight for the prime meerkat real estate known as the gosa dam burrow. But to be honest, Yucko's June have numbers in their favor, and so the gossas stood no chance. Cleo made a dangerous decision and only realized the risk when they were too close to the burrow. It was safer to turn tail and bolt back north to the safety of Bird's Nest Burrow, which, for now at least, was still firmly in their territory.
It came as a surprise that the gang would give up a burrow without a fight, as the gosa dam burrow was historically clearly theirs. But Cleo was smart enough to realize that strength lies in numbers, and unfortunately, even the reunited gossas are no match for the yuccos in this department. It's early morning, and the gosa gang are still reeling from their altercation with yuccos June last night. Extra sentries have been placed on duty, and there is a lot of burrow maintenance going on. Burrow maintenance is basically everybody making their beds. The burrows are dug in soft sand, and so the opening needs constant attention.
Cleo divides her attention between the skies and her family members. Starsky, her mischievous son, is playing the clown as usual. The burrow always looks worse after he's moved through it. It surprises me how Cleo just allows him to get away with it. It would never happen if it was one of the girls. It must be the age-old mother-son bond.
Having recently given birth, Cleo is ravenous. She needs to eat to regain her strength so she can mate again and hopefully be more successful next time. They head off as a united group and hope that there will be insects, small reptiles, and maybe even a scorpion or two on the menu. All of them know they have to work for it. Well, most of them do. As usual, Napoleon is resting under a tree. This lazy meerkat prefers to beg for or steal food rather than actually finding it himself. But the rest of the group will not give up the food they found without a fight. So Napoleon needs to be quick and careful. Priscilla was born to dig and always seems to know where to find food. Digging is hard work, but the rewards can be sweet. Meerkats love to eat scorpions, which are plentiful in the Kalahari. They seem to have developed a resistance to the powerful venom many scorpions carry in their stings, and seem to suffer little ill effect from getting stung. Suddenly, a lone meerkat is seen on the edge of the gosa territory. It is one of the males from Yucca's June, and he is on the lookout for females. If he is not the alpha male, it is likely that the females in his own group will not mate with him, and so in desperation, he has made this dangerous move.
If Cleo spots him, we may see some serious meerkat aggression, but her focus is still on the skies and her surrounding family.
The male sets his sights on Solo as he senses her vulnerability. Having been on her own for a long time, she is still nervous and easily influenced. She can't help but take the bait. It is an extremely dangerous move and one that could lose her the group again. Even worse, if she does get pregnant, then her life may be threatened. Solo and the sly male head off on their own. Fortunately, Cleo has not spotted them and is none the wiser. On his way out of the gosa territory, the intruder is spotted, and Solo is left to face the rest of the group all by herself. She wisely acts extremely submissive and tries to make up for her transgression by extensive grooming of the other meerkats.
Solo is playing a dangerous game, but it looks like she's gotten away with it this time. I just hope, for her sake, that she is not pregnant.
The vast landscapes of the Kalahari Desert are the perfect place for meerkats. The soft sand makes digging good living quarters easy, and the area is littered with tasty morsels for them to eat. The many herbivores that share this Eden offer additional protection from predators. But winter is on its way, and while the middle of the day can still be hot, temperatures plummet to well below freezing at night.
Due to the longer, colder nights of the approaching Kalahari winter, the meerkats are coming out of the burrow much later in the mornings. Sometimes I'm left to wait up to an hour until their little faces pop up above the hole. I had to go to the nearest town and buy warmer gear in preparation for the days ahead.
One meerkat that needs the protection of the group more than ever now is pregnant Delilah.
Cleo's sister, Delilah, has made the potentially fatal mistake of getting herself pregnant. Her belly is now looking very swollen, and it can't be long until she is ready to give birth.
The problem is that Cleo will soon be ready to mate again, and will likely want her own pups to grow up without any competition from others, not even from her own sister's pups.
If Delilah is lucky, Cleo may tolerate the arrival of her pups, mainly because the gosa gang is currently so small and needs to grow. But the meerkat hierarchy may mean that Cleo will more than likely try to kill these pups. Poor Delilah, it's her first litter, and this would be a terrible and traumatic event.
Cleo rules with an iron fist and rigorously abides by her own rule that there will be no other pregnant females in her group. Today, she wants to scare Delilah and make her realize that what she has done is wrong. The key character in Cleo's security team is Gandalf. He is the dominant male and father of the kids. His main job is to mark their territory to make it clear that this is their land. He also heads up the sentry team, and is often seen on the highest branch surveying the vast landscape for predators. But for now, he needs to also spend some time looking after Cleo. He knows that he is her first choice for breeding, but can't rest on his laurels, and so he is spending a lot of time grooming her to make sure other males don't try to curry her favor. Personal hygiene is very important for meerkats. Grooming yourself and others and removing parasites keeps them healthy, and the interaction also creates and reinforces the social structure of the group. Research has shown that grooming relaxes meerkats as well, reducing heart rate and lowering concentrations of stress hormones. With Delilah being pregnant, it has made Cleo extremely cross, and the grooming is helping her with the stress.
It's early morning here in the Kalahari, and after a late start, the gosa gang have headed off to forage for the day. Before I moved off in their direction, I caught a glimpse of a lone meerkat coming through the grass towards me. It was Delilah, and she was heading for the burrow that the rest of the gang had just left. As she disappeared down below, it struck me that she must be ready to give birth, and felt that this was the safest place.
Giving birth in a disused burrow would mean that there would be no protection for the pups. Delivering them here at the gosa gang's burrow is risky, but her only real option. Back at the foraging site, it has been a long day for the foragers, and the midday heat is taking its toll.
Yeah.
Suddenly, everyone is startled by an alarm call. Gandalf has realized that his gang are in trouble. A jackal buzzard has them under surveillance. This bird is looking for dinner. Buzzards usually take their prey from the ground and kill it using their sharp claws, and then take it to a secluded spot where it is torn into small pieces and eaten. The teenagers are terrified, but in true meerkat style, they show a united front. The bird decides it's not worth trying to divide this team and heads off to look elsewhere.
With all of the commotion around the buzzard, I failed to see that Cleo was missing from the group. This was very unusual. I headed back to the burrow with a feeling of dread. Delilah was there, and maybe Cleo picked up on this. I don't want to know what might be happening down there. To say that the relationship between these two sisters has soured is an understatement. I really hope Cleo has spared her pups. As I arrived, Cleo emerged from the hole. But what had she done? She may have handed out some bush discipline to Delilah, but how harsh this was, only time will tell. I wonder whether the pups are still alive. I guess we will only know in a few weeks when they are old enough to come up out of the burrow.
Later that evening, when the gang were back from foraging and bonding around the burrow, Delilah was there too. She looked distinctly slimmer, but very subdued. Who knows what has happened and what will happen? Tomorrow is another day. Cleo was really keen to get the group moving this morning, and she cut their burrow time short. But Delilah stayed back at the burrow with Brutus, whilst the others went foraging.
I hope that the pups are still alive and well inside the burrow. Brutus is a beta male and very submissive to Delilah. I've always thought that he has had his eye on her, and he often grooms her instead of Cleo.
As the day draws on, the foraging group are still out, and this is unusual. Most days, they will pop home to the burrow at least once or twice.
I went to find them, and Cleo was leading the way. They all seemed to be moving very fast and not interested in foraging. It dawned on me that this could be a burrow move rather than a foraging trip. Maybe Cleo wanted a fresh start in a new area. Either way, they didn't want to be near the now lifeless pups.
Back at the burrow, Brutus decides to go and look for them. He, after searching for an hour, still has not spotted them. He returns to Delilah, and the pair seem tense and stressed.
They are beginning to realize that they've been abandoned. But why are they still here? Are the pups alive below, or is it just confusion that is preventing Delilah from leaving? I will never know, The camera is too large to send down into the burrow. Delilah is now left in a strange position. If the pups are alive, then she no longer has the protection of the group to help her raise them, and they are likely to be killed anyway. But if she leaves to join the group, she will certainly seal their fate.
Delilah and Brutus finally make the impossible and tragic decision to head off and find the group. We will never know if the pups were dead or alive at the point of their departure, but there's no hope for them now.
What a traumatic turn of events for Delilah, but also for the gang that desperately needs more members.
Cleo has moved her group to the northern burrow. This burrow is on the edge of the territory of another gang of meerkats, known as the Rockstars. The Rockstars are another large group like Yakko's Dune. But their alpha male is a large animal that defends his territory aggressively, so the gosa gang must be careful not to wander in by mistake. There seems to be more cleaning house going on than normal, but this is probably because it is a new home and they need to make it their own. Meerkats rotate burrows as the burrow system itself needs to regenerate at regular intervals while the feces left behind becomes food for other animals and the parasite load decreases. Delilah seems very aloof, and both Brutus and Napoleon seem to be trying to make her feel better. As they head off to forage, the group immediately splits. Delilah leads the way in the splinter group, with Napoleon, Brutus, and Dingaan following her.
Delilah seems to be distancing herself from Cleo. Her pups are now dead, and this is devastating for any mother. I have a feeling she may now want to challenge Cleo's position as leader. She already has the support of three males, Napoleon, Brutus, and Dingaan. Delilah wants to be dominant. Research has shown that newly dominant females develop physiological and behavioral characteristics that help them to control other group members. They get heavier and more aggressive. I'm going to watch Delilah closely to see which way the situation will swing.
But today, she only has one thing on her mind: food. Having given birth yesterday, she is starving hungry. Immediately she finds a beetle deep under the ground. This juicy treat is a great start to the day. Meerkats always forage for their food in groups, but catch and eat their food alone, as their diet usually consists of small portions. As they search for their food, they spread out so each can search a different area of the desert floor. This time of year, in late summer, when desert grass stands up to 3 feet tall and food is abundant, they will forage close together. However, when the grass disappears and food becomes sparse, they will spread out more so each meerkat can find enough to eat. Most of the meerkat's food lives underground, and their bodies are specially adapted for finding and getting it. Their noses are extremely sensitive, and their front claws are curved and used as shovels. They often have to dig their own body weight in dirt just to get a small insect, but can do this in no time at all. Foraging for a meerkat is a continuous sequence of searching and digging, all the while moving forward with the gang in their endless search for food. The splinter group have their new queen Delilah. But who will be king? Napoleon tries a bit of scent marking, but soon gives up. He is too lazy and disorganized to be king. Brutus, on the other hand, has always liked Delilah and tries to seize this opportunity to get first dibs on mating rights. Meerkats can breed every 2 months, but more often tend to only successfully breed 2 to 3 times a year. At times, food is plentiful.
Delilah seems uninterested in breeding again. It could, however, be that Brutus and Napoleon are just not suitable enough for this new queen. It could also be that she does not want to give birth in winter again and will delay mating until spring.
Cleo's group is now only 7 meerkats strong, but Iron Lady Cleo does not let this faze her. She is constantly making contact calls to the other 6 to make sure that they are close. Meerkats have many different calls, and the most widely used is a chirruping that makes sure that the group are all close and no one has disappeared. Gandalf is not letting Cleo out of his sight. He is now very keen to mate with her again, and so continuous grooming, along with good protection, is the name of the game. He suddenly makes an alarm call as he has made a disturbing discovery. A Cape Cobra with a deadly bite and a fast strike has moved into one of the bolt holes. The meerkat's territory is scattered with these little holes that are used during the day to hide from predators. The burrow is usually too far away, and so they need something to bolt down when feeling threatened. Unfortunately, the snake is squatting in one of their holes, and they now want him out. As usual, the group gives a show of strength and unity. Mobbing this deadly creature will hopefully force it to move on. Most prey animals hide or run away when confronted with a potential predator, but the exact opposite behavior, mobbing, occurs in meerkats. However, scientists have long thought that selfless protection of the group was the primary reason for such risky behavior.
The meerkats irritated the snake enough to make it move from its hiding place, but now it is amongst the group and becoming very aggressive.
In all the commotion, it seems that Cleo has been hurt.
The attack on Cleo was lightning fast, and I didn't see her get bitten in the commotion. If she has been bitten, then this is a disaster. Already her group is down to 7, and the only reason they are still strong is because of her great leadership. If she can no longer unite her family, then who knows what will happen.
Now Cleo has a dilemma. Should she stay with her foraging group for safety? In her weakened state, she will be vulnerable to predators. Or should she try to limp down the burrow hole? Being on her own out here and hurt would make her a prime target for birds of prey. She is terrified and will need all her strength and the support of the group to get through this.
Experience tells me that meerkats rarely survive a Cape Cobra bite, and this could very well be fatal. If Cleo dies, then everything will change.